It was just after sunset in Bayou Black when I walked up to a cage and skinning a nutria nailed to a telephone pole and began my spiel. Do you ever get samples left on the doorknob? Things like toothpaste, washing powder, and stuff? The trapper politely informed me that he was prepared to shoot me when I came traipsing into his yard, except I looked harmless. If I was selling something, he weren't interested. I backed off. Now, in my hippie youth, it was considered a badge of honor to get arrested. Don't trust anyone over 30 is the famous catchphrase of the era, but don't trust anyone who hasn't done time was equally prized. I thought it infinitely preferable to avoid jail time than to get caught. Nevertheless, in my 18th year, I landed in the Hooskow in Laurel, Mississippi, for a few hours, not as a long-haired hippie, but a traveling salesman. After high school, I resolved not to go to college. I was content to lie around Mom's apartment and occasionally help neighbors with chores or watch their kids for a few dollars. Otherwise, I played my guitar and read books. Nice work if you can get it. One day, my sister, a newly minted housewife, arrived to jolt me awake. If you live here and eat Mom's food, you have to contribute. Get a job, help her with the bills, or move out on your own. So I cut my hair a long time ago, learned to shave, bought a necktie, and started job hunting. I had no work experience, no skills, no trade, no driver's license. I couldn't even drive. But I got an interview at International Learning Systems in downtown New Orleans. To get there, I had to take the slow as cold molasses veterans highway bus from Mom's neighborhood, called Fat City, and transfer to a Canal Street bus on the efficient New Orleans public service lines. International Learning System sounded highfalutin, but all they did was sell encyclopedias door to door. The unpaid week-long training session was like cheerleader camp. I was assigned to a crew led by a bloated, red-haired, red-faced guy named Chuck. His main squeeze, Lynette, rode shotgun in Chuck's black Lincoln Continental. In the back with me sat a curly-headed fellow named Steve Gelfand, whose surname seemed to incorporate elf and gremlin. He was a Brooklynite who reminded me of Jewish comedians my mom loved watching on Johnny Carson. Gelf fit a prototype of friends and acquaintances I met back then, kids who came to New Orleans for Mardi Gras and ended up staying for a year or three before moving on to the next phase of their lives. We made a real Mutt and Jeff team. I, rail thin and 6 foot three, with a wide blue striped tie and white shirt. He, a pudgy 5'6", with one eyebrow askance, arrayed in plaid shirts and polka dot ties. That's true. With Chuck at the wheel, we'd go spinning out of the city into the hick towns and suburbs nearby. The plan was to canvass particular neighborhoods where likely marks lived. Our ideal customers were young, working-class young marrieds who might want a set of encyclopedias to elevate the minds of their youngins and ensure their access to the American dream. On a day that New Orleans was crippled by a blizzard that left an inch of snow on the streets, we crossed the Mississippi River Bridge just before it was shut down to save the drivers from themselves and motored south to Bayou Black. Here, Chuck demonstrated a triumphant performance in the trailer of a Cajun offshore oil worker who already had three sets of encyclopedias shelved along the wall. Chuck executed the sales pitch to perfection and signed the guy for one more set. Then Gelf and I were released to troll the area, trudging in opposite directions. Chuck warned us sternly to watch out for cops. At that time, many communities had blue laws regulating sales. Small town folks were suspicious of men in neckties roaming the streets in the evenings, especially after sunset. We were wary of antagonizing residents who might call the cops or shoot us themselves. That's when I heeded that Cajun trapper's advice and moved on. Because I had grown up in South Louisiana, I was generally able to ingratiate myself with prospective clients and allay their fears. Not so the Gelf, who was jailed plenty of time. The sheriffs must have warned each other about some crazy Yankee ambling about scaring folks right on their front porch. So we headed into southern Mississippi, hoping the authorities there had not been forewarned. Chuck dropped us off in a shady neighborhood in Laurel and went to book a motel. Gelf and I moseyed off in opposite directions. After an hour of futilitarian door knocking, a police cruiser greeted me at curbside. The officer informed me that it was against the law to sell door to door in Laurel after dark. And though I gave him the company line about placing samples, he invited me into the back seat of his car. When we reached the jailhouse, Gelf was already there. His arrest had in fact triggered mine. After fingerprinting, they escorted us to a small cell in the back. On the top bunk was a plate of dried up old beans crawling with flies.
"Don't y'all take none of our good bull crabs, huh?"
said the deputy as he locked the door. The scene was mildly amusing. Laurel's boys in blue seemed more Barney Fife than Kojak. Gelf told me not to worry. When we failed to arrive at our pickup spots at 9, Chuck would come bail us out. Famous last words. From down the hall, a voice called, "What y'all in for?" "Selling encyclopedias after dark." "What you in for?" "Murder." "But I never done it." Gelf and I looked at each other. "Murder?" "They found my shotgun in the trunk of my car, but I never done it. It was a black guy done it." He didn't use the word black guy. Funny, our conversation died at that point. How do you respond to that sort of non-confessional? We leaned on the grimy walls and waited for good old Chuck to bail us out, which he did in his predictable chuckling blowhard style. A few nights later, he dropped me off in that land of endless apartment complexes called Fat City, where my mom rented. I was in existential crisis. After 2 months on the job, I had sold 6 sets of books, each netting me $60. Because I had to cover my own expenses on the road, however, I had saved nothing. But I wanted to go out in glory. I had to sell one more set before I gave my resignation. I was greeted at the next door I knocked by a nervous young fellow waving a gun and dancing back and forth from foot to foot. "It's loaded," he said. "I have a tranquilizer that'll knock down an elephant. I just had my stereo ripped off. What do you want?" Do you ever get those samples left on your doorknob? You know, shampoo, toothpaste, maybe breakfast cereal. You got a minute? He did. And after apologizing for his scary behavior, he listened to the shtick, examined the samples, signed on the dotted line, and gave me a check for $60. When Chuck picked me up that night, I handed over the check and announced, "I quit." Last time I saw the Gelf, he had brought home a prostitute who lacked the appropriate credentials. It was a man. And he headed back toward Brooklyn. I never got arrested again, and I ain't sorry. You can trust people who haven't served time.